to the skies, heavy with blessing. Lift your eyes, offer your heart. Jesus Christ, open the heavens. Now we receive the Spirit of God.
Well, good morning, church family. We're glad you're here with us to worship and fellowship together today. If you wouldn't mind coming on in and grabbing a spot, we're going to get things going, singing some songs to the Lord this morning. God and firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. Nations rise and fall, kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. Unmatched in all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign. Every knee will bow. Bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus. Oh, oh, we trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, you are victorious. Oh. We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high. We God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
Amen. Good morning. It's good to see you here in our second service, and good to have you with us today. If you're visiting, we want to welcome you, want to encourage you. Around you in the back of the seats, there's a couple of cards like this. We've done something new. If you are a regular and you haven't been here, you may not have heard this, but we've changed up our card. We used to have just one card that you could fill out, but now we have two. One says prayer on it, one says let's connect. And so if you've got a prayer request, you can fill that out and drop that in any of the black boxes at the exit and entrance there. And I'll get that, and we'll be praying for you. And if there's a need, if you need me to contact you, you can also put that on there. On the Let's Connect card, if you're visiting with us, we'd like for you to fill that all out. Or if you've been visiting with us and you have some questions or want some information, certainly fill that out. Again, drop that in the offering box there, and I'll be getting that certainly each week, and so I just want to encourage you to do that. If you're visiting with us for the first time, or maybe you've been a few times, and you haven't picked up one yet, there's a blue folder like this out on our welcome table there, as on the left as you go out, and it's got a lot of information inside that can help you know about what we believe and some of our ministries. It's got my contact information in there, so if you want to reach me or reach out to me, certainly feel free to do that. Again, just glad to have you with us this morning. A couple of quick announcements before we get started into the rest of our worship time. Don't forget that October the 24th, the Pumpkin Bowl, we'll be doing that. It's a flag football game at 10 a.m. at the football field. And so if you can be a part of that, we'd love to have you. All ages are welcome to that. Don't forget also, we're doing our trunk or treat on October 31st. That'll be from 5:30 to 7:30, just right out front here. And if you're interested in having a trunk as part of the trunk or treat that night, please sign up in the lobby there again on the welcome table. There's a clipboard you can fill out and let us know. Stephanie's heading that up, so we appreciate, there's Stephanie. We appreciate her doing that. Also, we have a box out in the lobby as well that if you want to donate candy, if you can't participate but you want to help out with providing candy, we'd love for you to do that as well. Also, you'll see in your bulletin that we're still offering MOM, which is Moms of Munchkins. That's from 11:30 to 1:30, and that's right here in the Fellowship Hall. It's a great time for mothers to come with their kids and let them spend time together and just have some great fellowship with other moms. And Allie heads that up. And so if you have any questions, or if you want to find out more about it, certainly call the front office and we can get you in touch with her. And then finally, you'll see there, if you're part of our youth, our student ministry, 6th grade through 12th grade, don't forget that we're preparing for a base camp winter camp, January 29th through the 31st. And if your student's interested, encourage them to sign up on Wednesday nights or to get in touch with David, find out some more information about costs. That's the same camp that we did the summer camp at for those that went. And so if you'd like to participate in our winter camp in January, please let him know, and he can give you more information. Sorry if I'm not moving around, or if this group over here is not going to see me as much. I told the first service I went bowling with Luke yesterday, and I don't know what I've pulled, but I pulled something, and 50 has just not been, as the closer I get to it, the worse it seems to get, so but I've taken some medication, and so hopefully I can move around a little bit better as the day goes on. But again, we welcome you. We're glad you're here to worship with us. We're going to worship through songs in just a few moments. But before we do, let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we thank you so much for our time this morning to be able to gather together. The time we had, 8:30, our small groups and just the fellowship and the teaching and just being in God's Word, and then now this service, we're just thankful that we can gather together and worship you and just celebrate what we have in Jesus Christ. We know that it is because of Him our sins have been forgiven. We have eternal life through His death and resurrection. And so we rejoice in that. That's what brings us here this morning. For no other reason, just to come and celebrate that and worship You, God. And as we look out and we see people from different ages, young and old, male and female, whatever, we're here because of what You've done in us. And so we want to worship You this morning. Praise You through song. Praise You through the study of Your Word. And God, we just thank You for the work You've done in our midst, the healings we've seen, the continued healing, just how, God, You have worked through our church into this community, and we're thankful for that. God, we love You. We praise You. Now we want to just lift up Your name through song, and it's in Jesus' name I pray these things. Amen.
Amen. Well, let's go ahead and stand together and continue to worship through song this morning.
Story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. And I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about His healing, of His precious blood revealing, how He made a lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion He's built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Thank you.
stood before creation, eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. You stood before my failure, carried the cross for my shame. Sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand. So what can I say? What can I do but offer this on, oh God, completely to you? So I'll walk upon alive in me, a life to declare your promise, my soul now to stand. So what can I say? What can I offer this heart, oh God, completely to you? So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all. Stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, to you surrendered, all I am is yours. So what can I say? What can I do but offer this heart, oh God, completely? What can I say? What can I do but offer this heart, oh God, completely to you? I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all. lost in my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all I am is yours, Jesus, all I am is yours.
Amen.
With God the Lord Most High, your hidden glory in creation now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. Our sin was great, your love was greater, so what can separate us now? What a wonderful name it is, what a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is,
The name of Jesus, what a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus, what a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. Father, we come to you this morning and we praise you for that truth that your name has power. Your name is beautiful. It's mighty. Nothing can stand against you, Lord. Father, we thank you for the privilege to be here today to worship you, to sing these praises. Father, I ask that you would fill this place with your Spirit, that you would bless us this morning as we've gathered together for the study of your word, for the singing of your praises, and for the encouragement of the body. Father, we just thank you so much that you are who you are, that you've done what you've done for us. God, what a privilege it is to worship you. We pray that through us, through our voices, through our opening your word, through our encouragement, that you would be glorified today, that your name would be lifted on high, and that nothing else could compete with you this morning, Lord, in our hearts and minds. Father, we just thank you for the opportunity to be here, that we can gather and do this morning. We love you and we praise you, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
We do offer our children's church for pre-K through second grade if you're interested, and they'll be taking them upstairs, and we appreciate our volunteers who do work with those kids. Well, if you would turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3. I didn't mention it in the first service, but I'll share with you guys and our folks online live. Many of you know our daughter Rayanne, and if you don't know the news already, we're excited. She got engaged this week and is going to be getting married sometime. I don't know when. Probably late spring, early summer, but we're excited for her and our future son-in-law Christian. So be praying for them, and he'll be graduating in December and she'll have another year left. So, but we're excited for them and just appreciate both of their desire and their heart for the Lord. So I'll be praying for them. I just wanted to share that with you guys. We're going to be in 1 Peter chapter 3, looking at verses 18 through chapter 4, verse 6. If you don't have a Bible this morning, there's one like this somewhere around you probably. You can grab that and use that this morning. If you don't have a Bible at home, we'd love for you to take that with you as our gift to you for just free. We just want you to be in God's Word. So we believe it is the holy and inerrant and inspired, infallible Word of God. And so we are continuing our journey through the book of 1 Peter. Now, this letter written by the Apostle Peter to Christians that were certainly dealing with some very difficult times. Persecuted, a lot of suffering. Many of them had been pushed out of their homes. They had been pushed out of their communities. They were considered outcasts. They were despised by those around them. It was a very difficult existence for these first century Christians. And the reality is, it wasn't getting any better. I believe God in His sovereignty obviously knew what was about to come. It was about to get a whole lot worse for these Christians who were scattered over all of what would be modern-day Turkey today and the Roman Empire. And they were about to face some extreme tests. And in this, Peter writes this letter under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to these Christians. And I believe you and I today, we somewhat feel like exiles too, because we are like these first century Christians. We are pilgrims. We are, as Scripture says, sojourners or strangers in this land. The reality is much of the culture is counter to what the Bible says. It's counter to what we believe as Christians. And so oftentimes we find ourselves at odds with those around us. And certainly this group of people would, to a much greater extent even than what we probably will ever know in our lifetime. I believe it's coming and it's going to get worse before the Lord comes. But these people certainly understood what suffering looked like. In fact, from the very beginning, Peter says, listen, I know that you're pilgrims. I know that you're strangers. You're exiles in this land. But he would go on to say right there in the first couple of verses of this letter, but let me remind you who you are in Christ. You are the elect of God. You are Christians. You are the chosen exiles. You are believers in Jesus Christ. You are part of the family of God. You have been adopted into the family of God through Jesus Christ. And he begins to encourage them. And throughout this letter, we've just seen so much truth, so much about who God is, and so much encouragement for not only these early Christians, but for you and me today. And Peter then goes on to tell this group of Christians, he's like, listen, I know it's difficult, I know it's hard, but live for the glory of God. He says, be God's holy people. He says, God is holy, therefore we're holy. He says, live like holy people. Live like God's people. Follow Him. Let the world look in and see a church that is on fire for Jesus Christ. Let the world look in and see a church that is loving one another fervently. That is, with everything you have. Let the world look in and see a people of God tending to each other's needs, caring for one another, submitting to the governing authorities, submitting to one another. He even threw in husbands and wives, and we talked about that. And we get to this place now, just last week, that Peter would say, listen, while we face suffering and persecution, and we're going to, even when we're trying to do everything that God wants us to do, we will face suffering and persecution for doing what is right. And so Peter says, listen, this is the right way to respond to that. Because that's really what the world sees. Peter's already said on an occasion that let our conduct be honorable among the Gentiles. That is, among the lost. And that's what we would say today. Let our conduct, let what we do be honorable among the Gentiles, among the lost people, among the darkness. And so Peter would say, listen, that's the big issue. How are you going to respond when suffering comes? How are you going to respond when persecution faces you, when it comes knocking at your door? How are you going to be? And he's telling the people here just exactly what that looks like. And so last week we saw these three truths. We saw that Christians will suffer even when they are doing right. Secondly, we saw that Christians can rest assured even in the midst of that suffering. And finally, he said, it is better to suffer for good than for doing evil. What we pick up in verse 18 of chapter 3 is Peter really continues this thought of suffering even when we are his followers. And so that's where we look at today. And it is a lengthy passage of scripture, but if you're able, I'm going to ask you to stand as we honor the reading of God's holy and inspired word. Starting in verse 18, now Peter's been talking about this suffering for right, what that looks like. And then he says in verse 18, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit, by whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison, who formerly were disobedient, when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight souls, were saved through water. There is also an antitype which now saves as baptism, not the removal of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers having been subject to Him. Therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same mind. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh for the lust of men, but for the will of God. For we have spent enough of our past lifetime in doing the will of the Gentiles, when we walked in lewdness, lust, drunkenness, revelries, drinking parties, and abominable idolatries. In regard to these, they think it strange that you do not run with them in the same flood of dissipation, speaking evil of you. They will give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this reason, the gospel was preached also to those who are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the Spirit. May God bless the reading of his word. You may be seated. The opening verse of this section might look familiar. If you were to go back just a page or so, maybe in your Bible, to chapter 2, verse 21, Peter writes there, "For to this you were called, you were saved," he said, "because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps." And so Peter makes a similar statement again here, reminding the reader of this letter, this truth, that Jesus Christ suffered, and he suffered for us. That's where we're going to jump off this morning. That's the first truth. That's the only truth we're going to look at in this text. We're going to look at two things. The truth that Jesus Christ suffered for us. And then we're going to look at the reality, the response. What do we do with that? How do we live in light of this truth that Jesus Christ suffered for us? Well, Peter begins this section with that statement. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. The first thing Peter says here is Christ suffered once for sins. Now, the Bible tells us elsewhere in the book of Hebrews and reminds us often that Christ's death on the cross was enough. It was enough to cover the sins of any of us who would believe in Him. The Bible says that Christ died one time. See, He doesn't have to keep dying. It's not like the Old Testament where they took the lamb and put it on they slain it and put the blood on the mercy seat, and they had to do that often, right? They had to keep coming back and doing that for the forgiveness of the sins of the people. But the Bible said Jesus came. He was the perfect Lamb of God. He was the perfect sacrifice on the cross. So His death happened once. His blood covered the sin once and took care of it. And it reminds us, too, of our security in Christ, that our salvation rests in the work of Jesus Christ, not in what we can do. Paul reminds us that in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. We see it elsewhere, that Christ died. It's His work on the cross. It's not what you and I done. We can't attend enough Sunday school class. We can't attend enough Bible studies. We can't pray enough. We can't read our Bible enough. We can't memorize enough verses. We can't give people enough money to help them out. We can't do enough things to satisfy a holy God. It is our sin that is the punishment. For the wages of sin is death. That is not physical death, but also spiritual death. We've been eternally separated from God. And Christ, He died once. And so what is Peter saying here? Peter's saying, listen, I know you're suffering. Okay, I know great persecution is happening. And he said, I know you feel abandoned, but believe you me, you have not been abandoned. Because Jesus Christ is with you. And listen, He suffered. And not only did He suffer once, look what else He says there. The just for the unjust. Peter says, yes, you're suffering, but don't lose hope. He says, let these truths about the suffering of Christ serve to encourage you. And as we look at these, I hope they will encourage us today. And the reality is, Peter says here, Christ, the just, the perfect one, the sinless one, died for the unjust. That's the reality. When John said, here comes the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world, he's the perfect Lamb. He was sinless. He never sinned. He never did wrong. And yet he had to go and he had to die on that cross. Peter says, you suffered. You think you suffer for doing right. Think about Christ. He did everything right. And he still went to that cross. If you were to look at Romans chapter 5, verse 8, Romans chapter 5, verse 8 says this, but God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God demonstrates his own love. How? That while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Listen, before you and I were even born, Christ died on that cross for our sin. Now listen to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. 2 Corinthians 5, 21. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Listen, the reality is, and what Peter is saying here, and what Paul says in Romans 5, 8, what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5, 21, is that the Bible is clear. Jesus did something for you and me that we did not deserve, nor did he deserve it. We didn't deserve for him to take our place on that cross. What did we deserve? We deserved death. We deserve eternal punishment. We deserve the very wrath of God for our sin. And yet, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. We were the guilty. We were the sinners. Jesus never sinned. Jesus didn't have to die, but he did for you and me. He died for us. The sweet hymn reminds us, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Someone once said it this way, said, quote, Jesus paid a debt he did not owe because we owed a debt we could not pay. That's the reality of what Scripture teaches us. You and I, we had a debt that was beyond anything we could do. We couldn't pay it. It's impossible to pay it because we're fallible. We have errors. We sin. We're sinners. We're guilty. We're stained. And yet the one who's not stained, the one who's infallible, the one who's inerrant, the one who is no sin, took our place, even though he didn't owe it. Jesus suffered on the cross, dying in our place for our sins, but he didn't stay there. That's the beauty of it. See, the gospel doesn't stop with Jesus on the cross. So too often, sadly, that's where we leave it. But we got to take it further than that. Look what Peter says. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being what? Put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit. That is, his dead body was made alive again. That's what sets Christianity apart from other religions. We don't worship a dead God. We don't worship a dead Jesus. He didn't stay in that tomb. He was resurrected. Romans chapter 8, verse 11, the Apostle Paul writes here, if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. What a beautiful, beautiful thing that is. What a wonderful truth. It's because of his resurrection. See, yes, Jesus was placed in that tomb, but he didn't stay there. We know the Bible tells us 3 days later, he was resurrected. He accomplished what he came to do. Sin was defeated. defeated. Death was defeated. You and I, when we believe in Jesus Christ, when our faith is in Jesus Christ, His death, His resurrection on that cross, you and I now have eternal life. Jesus would say, though we may die physically, we live. Why? Because He says, I'm the resurrection and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. And though he may die, he will live. Peter goes on to say that in doing this, this dying and being made alive, what is he said there? That he brings us to God. Jesus' mission on this earth was to seek and to save that which is lost, those who are lost, to save them and bring peace between them and God the Father, to save them and give them complete and unhindered access to God the Father. And that is exactly what He has done. Listen, the Bible reminds us that through one man, Adam, sin entered the world and death followed, and death to all. That is, we all are guilty. We're all sinners. And we need saving. We need reconciliation. Paul would say that believers are ambassadors for Christ. To do what? To bring people to reconciliation with God. See, we broke fellowship when Adam sinned and violated the law of God, violated God's word. And therefore, as human beings, we need reconciliation that only happens through Jesus Christ. His death on the cross in our place, His triumphant resurrection enables there to be reconciliation between us and God. We are no longer enemies of God. We are now friends of God. We have been adopted into the family of God. Because of what Christ has done. Peter then goes on to illustrate this to the reader, what Christ has done in verses 20 through 21. Now this passage of Scripture is debated often. It's a very difficult passage at first glance to really understand and grasp. But I believe if we find the right interpretation here and we see it in the context, it helps us with the bigger picture of what Peter is teaching. And I won't get into all the different debates. Instead, I want to share with you what I believe is the accurate interpretation here. Remember, Peter is talking about believers suffering and how we must remember how Christ suffered for us, even though He didn't deserve it. The just for the unjust. And so what did Peter do? Peter takes these believers back to someone else who suffered, right? Who suffered wrongly for doing right, but in the end was saved through Jesus Christ. Who was it? Well, it was the Old Testament figure of Noah. Look what he says there. He says, verse 19, by whom also Jesus, he went and preached to the spirits in prison, who formerly were disobedient. When once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight souls, were saved through water. So what is Peter saying here? Peter is saying something that's a little different if we say it in English. And that is that what Peter is saying Jesus did is through Noah, the Spirit of God, through Noah, spoke to the wicked of Noah's day through Noah, who was a righteous preacher. We'll see that in just a minute. Who spoke to the unrighteous, who rejected Him, who died in the flood, who are now in hell, who are now in prison. And that's what he's talking about here. And he's saying, you know, just like Noah preached in his day and was rejected, he said, listen, you're suffering, you're telling people the will of God, you're preaching Christ, and they will come against you. He's already talked about suffering for what is right. And so Peter refers back to a familiar story to his readers. That would have a greater purpose to this letter he's writing. It would encourage Christians to stand for righteousness and try to influence those around them for the gospel in spite of the suffering that may come to them. Because listen, when we identify with Jesus Christ, we'll be saved from a greater judgment, but we may face man's judgment today. We will suffer. Verse 14 and 15, if you were to go back just a few verses, told us to not be afraid of their threats and the trouble that would befall them. Instead, be ready to tell of a hope. And so Peter here in our verses this morning tells the reader of what Christ did through the Spirit at the time of Noah. And this view is certainly supported within 1 Peter. Go back to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 11, just a couple of pages back. Chapter 1, verse 11, listen to what it says. Searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ who was in them was indicating when he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. To them it was revealed that, not to themselves, but to us, they were ministering the things which now have been reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. We see the Spirit of Christ through the prophets doing what? Telling of the Messiah to come. If you were to turn over to 2 Peter, that's the second letter that Peter writes, just back to the right some. You'll go to 2 Peter chapter 2. Listen to verse 5. And did not spare the ancient world. Talking about God did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of the eight people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly. Right? So he's talking about Jesus preaching through the Spirit of Christ, preaching through Noah to the people, the wicked people of Noah's day, and they rejected and now are in prison. That's why that verse looks kind of awkward in the English. But listen, the New American Standard says Christ preached to the spirits now in prison. And in the English today, this is how you might say the exact same thing he's saying right here. If I said I knew President Trump when he was in college, you would know I don't mean President Trump was president in college. I knew him as a college student. He's now president. So, when Peter writes there, going back to our text, he says, by whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison. That is, he went and preached to them through Noah, the spirits that are in prison today because of their wickedness. So that helps us because when we look at it that way, we see that Noah was saved ultimately, how? In the ark from the flood. And that would make sense in the context of what Peter's trying to say. Listen, I know you're suffering, but listen, Christ suffered. He would even go on to say, Noah suffered. You're going to suffer. But he would say, you're going to make it through. Look at verse 21. There is also an antitype which now saves us, baptism, not the removal of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God. How? Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That word antitype refers to an earthly expression of a spiritual or heavenly reality. It is a symbol or a picture or a pattern of a spiritual truth. So an antitype is really something that is foreshadowed or represented by a type or symbol. For instance, a character or event in the New Testament that is prefigured in the Old Testament. It is something that took place in the past, but is a symbol or a picture of what is to come. So what is the ark a picture of? What is the flood a picture of? The flood is a picture of the judgment of God on the people. And ultimately, the eternal judgment of God. And what is the ark a picture of? Well, who got saved? The righteous. It was Noah and his family, the other seven, right? They get into the ark. The ark is a picture of who? Christ. We are baptized into Christ, Paul would say in Romans. We are one with Him. We are in union with Him. And when we are baptized into Christ, when we are saved, when we are believers in Jesus Christ, we no longer will face the judgment of God. And so Peter, he's not teaching that immersion in water saves you. Peter pictures the waters of baptism as corresponding to, or an antitype, or a symbol of the deliverance of Noah's family, and for you and me, our deliverance through Christ today. Think of it. What is baptism today by immersion? Paul says in Romans that it is a picture of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that's what Peter is saying right here. And it says, I know you suffer. I know you're being persecuted. I know it's hard. I know you're doing right and people still hate you and they're coming against you. But understand, Christ suffered. He died once for your sin, for my sin. And it is through Him we have eternal life. That is the very hope that he was talking about earlier when he said, listen, be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you. We have hope because of what Christ has done. Peter says we are saved not only through Christ's death, but His life. And Peter says here, all right, now that you know this, okay, not only did He die, He's resurrected there in verse 22. He's ascended back to the right hand of God. He is our mediator. The book of Hebrews teaches us and helps us to understand. He's our intercession between us and God the Father. That is what Jesus Christ is doing right now for us, so that we have open access to God Himself through Jesus Christ. And so now Peter says, listen, this is what we do with this. Here's the truth. Christ suffered for us, the just for the unjust. So now let us live in light of this truth. Look at chapter 4 now, back here in 1 Peter, our text, verse 1. He says, therefore, okay, I just told you about the suffering. Therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same mind. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh for the lust of men, but for the will of God. Peter says, put away the old and live for the will of God. Paul would say in Galatians, don't live in the flesh, but walk in the Spirit. That old flesh will pull us and want us, right? Will want to tug at us and pull us down that old path. But we have a new path that's been set before us. If you would, turn over to Romans. It may even come up on the screen. Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6, verses 5 through 11. Flip to the next one. There you go. Romans 6, 5 through 11. Listen to what it says. For if we have been united together in the likeness of His death, that is Christ's death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of His resurrection, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with Him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. Verse 7, for he who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with Him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over Him. For the death that He died to sin once for all. But the life that He lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. What an amazing passage of Scripture. Chapter 5 and 6 is some of my favorite in the book of Romans. We just covered it this past Wednesday night. We've been going through the book of Romans. I'd encourage you to come if you're able to. We have children's ministries and youth ministries, so you can come in here, the adult Bible study. I would encourage you to come. Because listen, let us live in the light of this truth that God has freed us from the sin. We're no longer condemned because of sin. Does it mean we're going to live a sinless life? No, it just means that Christ paid for our sin. We are no longer bound to that sin. We can live a life of righteousness through Him. Is it hard? Yes, it's hard to do right. And when we even do right, we're going to suffer for it. But Peter says, be of one mind. We've been freed. Look back at verse 3. Peter says, we've spent enough of our lifetime in doing the will of the Gentiles. Now, this is an exhaustive list, but he says, listen, you've walked in lewdness, lust, drunkenness, revelries, drinking parties, abominable idolatries. And Peter says, listen, in regard to these, they think it strange that you do not run with them in the same flood of dissipation. And they're going to speak evil of you, Peter would say. Have you ever been there? You got saved, you started going to church, and people are, what's wrong with you? Who do you think you are now? Oh, you're holier than thou. You're one of them. I know. You know. I've heard it. I've been told that. I even have family members that have said that to me. Oh, you're a preacher now. Like that makes a big difference. No, I'm a Christian. That's what's different. It has nothing to do with me being a pastor. I'm still fallible. I still make mistakes. I still have flaws. But it's because of what Jesus did. That's what I rest my hope in. Lord knows I'm not going to rest it in me. It's what Jesus Christ did. And Peter says here that your honorable living, that honorable conduct before Gentiles, it's going to be opposed by those who are not followers of Christ. But look what he goes on to say, verse 5. They will give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. Peter says, listen, those that fight against you, war against you, come against you, those that reject Jesus Christ, will get their due. Not that we're excited about that or happy about that. That's a reality. That's a truth. Going back to what he said about Noah's day. Eight people in the world were righteous. And God saved them. And what did he do? He destroyed everyone else. If you were in our Roman study, you'd understand there is no innocent individual in this world. So if we have that idea that why would God do that to innocent people, there is none righteous, no, not one. We must have faith in Jesus Christ. Peter says, their sins, the way they treated you, that will be dealt with, that will be judged. Then look at verse 6. For this reason, the gospel was preached also to those who are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the Spirit. Two things about this text as we wrap up. He says, for this reason, the gospel was preached, right, to those who are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the Spirit. Listen, there's going to be those of us, right, that we're saved through Jesus Christ, right? That we're going to be judged by men. And Peter would say, listen, yeah, you're going to be judged by men, but live according to God in the Spirit because you have a hope in Jesus Christ. You're going to have an eternal life with Him. And the second thing it tells us is to make sure we're sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. I mean, this is clear indication. He says that they might be judged according to men in the flesh. That is, you might be judged by the world, but you're going to live according to God in the Spirit because there's something different about you. You've been changed. So we think laws can change human hearts. It can't. I'm not opposed for being a political activist, for saying we need certain laws. We certainly do. But no law that we ever make is going to change the heart of an individual. What changes the heart of an individual is the one who suffered once for our sins. The just for the unjust. And when we believe in Him, we will be changed. Peter has shown us that Christ, who was the perfect righteousness, willingly suffered for totally unrighteous you and me. And obviously, believers can never suffer the way Christ did. His suffering was for redemptive purposes. But we can suffer for righteousness' sake because He suffered and brought us into the kingdom of light. And understand this, as children of the light, and that's what a believer is. We've been called out of the darkness into the marvelous light of Christ. We are children of the light. Paul would say in Ephesians, live like it. Live like you're children of the light. He says, we are children of the light. We will be at constant odds with a kingdom of darkness. And there is a kingdom of darkness. Remember, Peter's intent in this section is to help believers arm themselves with faith in order to suffer for the sake of Christ and His kingdom, remembering that Christ suffered for us. He suffered for us. So when we're suffering, He suffered for us. And that's how we can get through the persecution, the anger, being despised, being ridiculed, because we know what Christ did for us. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank You so much for Your precious word today. God, You've reminded us over and over in Your word what an amazing thing You've done for us. Sending Your Son, not only to die that agonizing death, taking on our sin, sin that He didn't do, He didn't deserve the punishment He went through, but He did it humbly. And then in 3 days, He was resurrected, showing His victory, His mission was accomplished. Death has no dominion. Sin can no longer bind us. We are no longer condemned because of what You did through Jesus Christ. We praise You for that truth. In His name, amen. Well, as always, we use this time here at First Baptist. We're going to sing a song, but the Holy Spirit's been speaking to you. The Word of God maybe has spoken to your heart in some way, and we use it as a time of response or even invitation, or maybe you want to call it a time of reflection, whatever you, however you want to word it. But it's a time that as the Holy Spirit's working on you, maybe you want to know more about salvation. You're not a believer in Jesus Christ. You want to know more. You want to make sure things are right with you and God. I'd love to talk with you after the service about that. Maybe you've been right with God. You've never followed that with baptism. I'd love to talk with you about what baptism is and what it means. I can talk to you right after the service. However God is speaking to your heart this morning. Just use this time. We're going to stand now, though, and we're going to worship Him through song.
Is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones He came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on Him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. The ground, His body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave He rose again. And as He stands in victory, curse has lost its grip on me, for I am His, He is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. Life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from His hand. Till He returns and calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Till He returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Amen. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank You again to be able to gather, sing praises to You, to be able to lift up a song like that, to just be reminded, is Your power. That the same Spirit that rose Jesus from the grave dwells in us. The life we have is because of You. May we rejoice in that truth. And God, may we be missionaries. May we go out into our community and be ready to declare the truth, the hope that is in us through Jesus Christ. All service, everything we've done, God, it was to Your praise, to Your glory. We love You. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, set free.